We talked about onion routing and TOR, and now I'd like to address the prickly subject of hidden services, right, aka the dark web. So Max has done a good video on the dark web, and so you should definitely watch that one first, so you know what it is. But it's quite a controversial topic, because a lot of what happens on the dark web is illegal, right? There's no two ways about it, that is true. Some of it isn't, right? And a lot of what happens on TOR in general, in fact, the majority of what happens on TOR in general, you know, high into the 90% and above, is perfectly fine, right? It's just anonymous users browsing the web, doing regular things. But the TOR hidden services are the ones that the debate is about, because they're the ones where you sort of say, well, look, is it worth this bit of encryption? Is it worth, you know, all the criminality that's on there and so on? So here's my cloud, my TOR cloud, and in essence, we've got lots of people going into the network, lots of encrypted layers and things happening, bouncing around, and then people coming out of the network to servers, right? Now, the issue from a security standpoint is what happens if there's someone sniffing here and someone sniffing here, and they can correlate traffic between the in and the out and work out what it is that I'm doing specifically, right? Then the whole of TOR, the whole point of TOR, which is anonymization, has been defeated, right? We already have encryption, so that isn't the point of TOR. That's just how they do the anonymous communication. So the dark web, or a hidden service, as to use the proper term, is in essence where this server moves inside this cloud, right? So now we have a hidden service running inside this cloud, and there is no B. That's the idea, right? So it makes it very, very difficult to find. So there is now a circuit that goes somewhere between A, around the place, to this hidden service, and at no point has it left the network. So there's no traffic correlation that can be done, right? All of these are just TOR cell messages that all look exactly the same. Now, the way that TOR does this is very, very clever. And we'll look into a little bit of detail on the protocol that it uses. But it's managed to form a protocol where neither I nor the server know who each other are, but we can still have a conversation, which is kind of nifty. Okay. So then, let's start again with my onion routing. So onion routing is a protocol that could theoretically be implemented elsewhere. There's other mixing networks and things and other anonymization networks. But hidden services is predominantly the domain of TOR. And TOR has got the most users and the most nodes and is the biggest and is in the news the most. Let's draw a little bit of a network again. So I shouldn't have drawn these boxes like this because now it takes me ages. So here's my server. Here's my client. And these, I'm just going to draw them as boxes because otherwise it's going to take far too long. These are onion routers. So remember that in normal onion routing, the client will produce a circuit to some hops and then they will just talk to the server. But the server will be out on the normal web doing normal servery things and won't be anonymous. What hidden services do is anonymize this server. So they allow both the server and the client to talk to each other despite the fact that no one knows who each other is, which is quite impressive. Now, of course, if you then use that service connection to log in, they're going to know who you are, but you get the idea. The server has to lay some groundwork down before a client can actually use a hidden service, right? So there's protocols in the TOR specification for doing this. But what the server will do when they come online is they will pick three onion routers at random and name them as introduction points. So let's pick some at random. Now, these are just normal onion routers. They're very likely to be just doing regular, normal routing tasks like circuits through other clients and to servers and things. Some of these might be exit nodes, entry nodes, and so on. But as far as I know, all onion routers can also act as introduction points. It's not a big job, right? It doesn't require a huge amount of bandwidth. The server will make connections, circuits, to these introduction points. So these are full-on TOR circuits with three hops in between them. The idea being that these introduction points know they're going to be introducing people to this server, but they don't know who it is. Right, so already the server is hiding behind a layer of anonymity here. It will send them a message to say, I'd like you to act as an introduction point, and then it will create something called a hidden service descriptor, which I'll just write down here. That will include the server's public key for authentication purposes, but we won't dwell on that particularly, but also, crucially, the IP addresses of these introduction points here. Right, these are all public anyway, they're all publicly listed. Now, it will publish this descriptor to something called a distributed hash table. That is to say that all of the routers on TOR will hold some part of the information on all of these hidden services. And the idea is that if I try and look up a hidden service, the router responsible for it will give me back the descriptor, right, including the addresses of his introduction points. Now, The key for this hash table is the onion address, right? So the onion address that everyone knows about is actually derived from the public key of this server, and is in essence the key that gets these IPs out of the distributed hash table. The whole point of this is that the onion address isn't publicized on the global Tor network. You just find it other ways, like on an internet, or your friend tells you, or in an email, or something like this. The way that a distributed hash table is programmed, the vast majority of nodes won't know what the descriptor is for a given key. Right? Only one will, probably, or a couple. So there's an inherent security here. Until recently, it's also made it quite difficult to work out how many hidden services there were. So this is all set up now. The server sits there and waits for internet connections or people to ask for web files. Now, and these onion routers, these IPs, the introduction points, just sit there being normal routers and waiting. Here's me, I want to connect to this hidden service, and someone gave me the onion address. So that's really all I need. So what I do is I request the descriptor off the hash table, and it gives it back. That has the three IPs, and I pick one at random, right? Let's say this top one here. What I'm gonna do, in essence, the short version is, I'm gonna ask this IP to introduce me to a server, and then we're gonna meet in the middle at some rendezvous point. That's the idea. So let's work out how it works. I've sort of run out of colors, so I'm gonna go with the orange pen here. It's a bit bright. I choose a rendezvous point at random, and I create a Tor circuit to that rendezvous point. Remember that essentially all of these arrows are the full connections. This one has two hops on it, not three, because the rendezvous point is the third hop. So it goes on like this. Now, I send a message to the rendezvous point saying, I'd like you to introduce me to the server via this introduction point, and I want you to send it the word cookie. Right? Now that could be any string, it's not important. The point is it's sort of like a one-time password kind of thing to verify that no one else has got involved in this conversation. The rendezvous point creates a circuit to this IP and sends it the word cookie. It also sends its own address because, of course, this doesn't know it because it's a circuit and we need to be at a rendezvous here. So this IP forwards the cookie onto the server, and at this point, the server can either accept it and decide to try and make a connection or do nothing. Right? So you can imagine a situation where instead of a cookie, it's some kind of special password that you need to be able to connect to this website, and the server just does nothing. That's one thing that could happen. Right? They have an authentication token, I think. But at this point, the introduction point's job is done. There is no more. These have served their purpose. All they do is forward the cookie onto the server. Right? Bearing in mind, we don't know where it is. And the server decides whether it's going to connect. Let's assume, because otherwise this will be a much shorter video, that the server does want to talk to the rendezvous point. So it creates another circuit. I don't know how many, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, we're at 5. We've got 6 circuit, right? Across the Tor network to the rendezvous point.
So does the cookie have the rendezvous point details in it?
Yes. Right. The rendezvous point details will be, well, it will be attached to the same message with the cookie in, yes, good question. Now, the server sends the rendezvous point a rendezvous please, essentially message, with the cookie in it. And the rendezvous point looks at these two cookies and goes, well, I was requested a rendezvous by this guy with this cookie. I've received a connection from some server, also with the cookie. They must be talking about each other, right? That's the idea. It could be doing lots of rendezvous at the same time with different cookies. And it will then act as just another hop on this network and connect these two up. So this comes over here like this, and this comes down here, and they kind of get bridged by this rendezvous point here. From then on, the rendezvous point acts like a normal onion router and just decrypts messages, passes them out the other side, like always. So for anyone that's sort of lost count, there are at least 6 hops here, right? There's 2 intermediate nodes on this circuit, then the rendezvous point, then 3 intermediate nodes on this circuit, right? It's just part of the protocol, but there's only 2 this side. That's obviously going to be quite a lot slower than normal Tor. These could be all over the world like this. It's going to take quite a long time. But there is no real way of getting in on this conversation, right? If you're sniffing here or sniffing here, all you're seeing is encrypted Tor cells, all of 512 bytes long, jumbling around this place. You've just got no idea what any of them are, right? Very, very difficult to track. That's why it's so difficult to find hidden services.
Because they're hidden.
Because they're hidden, yeah. That's kind of the point. They could have named it something else. They didn't name it incorrectly, should we say. Sometimes there are vulnerabilities found in the protocol, right, or compromised nodes which allow hidden services to be found. This happened, for example, with Silk Road 2. But that's not that common, right? And as the bigger the network gets, the more of these different node combinations there are, the harder that process gets. Now, as an aside, some servers don't need anonymity, and this many hops is too slow, right? So they want to protect their clients, but they don't care about if people know who they are. Facebook, for example. So Facebook worked with Tor recently to introduce something called Single Onion. And in that case, the only difference is that this server doesn't bother with these three hops. It just goes straight to the rendezvous point. Now that obviously foregoes server's anonymity because the rendezvous point knows who it is. But it's Facebook, we know where the servers are, I think, right? So they don't mind about that. Their business is protecting their customers. They don't care that we know where their servers are. So that's an alternative, and it's quite a lot faster because you've removed three possibly global hops from there.
What benefit is there to Facebook to, you know, somebody just using a normal Tor connection to Facebook?
There's a small chance, if you're using a normal Tor connection, that someone will be sniffing here and sniffing here and do traffic correlation and work out what's going on, right? There is no chance of that happening when it's a hidden server. It never leaves the Tor network, that's the thing. If you imagine that cloud, you're talking to Facebook entirely inside that cloud. It's very hard to get in. But on the other hand, Facebook server location is actually known, because if you were operating a rendezvous point and Facebook said, we'd like to connect back to this client, you'd immediately know that's because it's Facebook server. So it's like a halfway compromise. And I think, you know, a fairly reasonable compromise.
So it's Facebook putting one foot inside the cloud, yeah?
Yeah, one foot inside the Tor cloud, yeah. This message here is encrypted once with K3. It's encrypted another time with K2. And then it's encrypted a final time with K1. Now, let's think about what that means. It means that only this router here...